Wochenend und Sonnenschein und dann mit dir im Wald allein. Weiter brauch ich nicht zum glücklich sein. Wochenend und Sonnenschein.
Greetings, YouTube misfits, miscreants, malcontents, and misanthropes. Claire here. This isn't my coffee, this is a fat ass cat. Come on in, we're going to talk about YouTube and YouTubers. It's a great day here in Chapel Hill, but nevertheless, we are going to endeavor to persevere and keep our spirits high in Soggy Bottom. About the most exciting thing I did all week was watch Fulham manage inexplicably to win 2-1 over Norwich despite only possessing the ball about 38% of the time. But wasn't that a gorgeous pass from Clint Dempsey to Damien Duff for the second goal? I got a lot of material today, so let's get to it.
You're so dumb, there's nothing to compare you with. You're dumber than the dumbest jackass. Look at each other, will you? Do you ever see anything like yourself for being dumb specimens?
This portion of Coffee with Claire brought to you by Santorum for President. Vote Rick America because he'll bring back those good old days.
There's where he labored so hard for his master, day after day.
We know the candidate Barack Obama, what he was like, the anti-war government.
That man is a nit.
In the field of yellow.
Hear that? I do believe that was Rick Santorum screwing the pooch.
Premise one, whatever begins to exist has a cause. Things don't come into being from nothing. Two, the universe began to exist. Three, therefore, a cause of the universe exists.
Tank, load the jump program. You have to let it all go, Neo. Fear, doubt, and disbelief. Free your mind.
That a beginningless, uncaused, timeless, spaceless, immaterial, enormously powerful, personal creator of the universe exists.
Enough of this airy persiflage. Let's talk about geology. You'll recall that last week I explained how Charles Lapworth named the Ordovician period, and in doing so, he ended a decades-long dispute between Adam Sedgwick and Roderick Murchison as to whether certain rocks in central Wales belonged in the upper portion of Sedgwick's Cambrian system or the lower portion of Murchison's Silurian system. Radiometric dating has established that the Ordovician represents the period of geologic time between about 488 million years ago and about 444 million years ago. Much of the Ordovician, like the Cambrian before it, was a greenhouse world, and at the beginning of the Ordovician, the atmospheric concentration of carbon dioxide was about 15% higher than it is today. For most of the period, much of North America was a great shallow marine shelf where tremendous thicknesses of limestone were laid down. It was a bit like the Bahamas today, only on a much vaster scale. By the way, if you spend much time driving on Interstate 40 and Interstate 81 in eastern Tennessee and southwestern Virginia, you'll spend a good deal of time driving atop this great limestone shelf. The formation of all that limestone led to the sequestration of a great deal of carbon that had formerly been in the atmosphere. The amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere gradually declined throughout the Ordovician, culminating in a plummet toward the end of the period in one of the great mass extinctions in geologic history. In the late Ordovician and the early Silurian, the world became an ice-house world, and continental-sized glaciation on the scale of Antarctica formed across what is now North Africa. So that's our geologic minute, which paradoxically took about 2 minutes. Next week, I think we'll take a break from explaining how geologic periods were named and consider something else in geology. Perhaps we'll talk about volcanoes. Seemingly, since the first day I arrived on YouTube, I have been subscribed to In Medias We Trust, a young man who makes fascinating videos. The following video deals with the situation in Uganda and reminded me of rabid, homophobic fantasist Scott Lively. More on him later in this video.
The Republic of Uganda is located in eastern Africa. Its president/dictator is a lovely fellow by the name of Yoweri Museveni. As part of the Second Congo War, Museveni had the Ugandan military invade the Democratic Republic of Congo. This alone has resulted in some 5 million plus deaths. There is one more thing. Remember this? Lively believes homosexuals and homosexuality were behind the Nazi Party and that the Holocaust was itself an aspect of the, quote, gay agenda, end quote. The book's publication marks the point at which Uganda's anti-gay community first took notice of Lively, eventually leading to his speaking engagement at a conference there. That would be the conference largely credited with the formation of Uganda's current anti-gay movement and the tabling of the all-too-familiar anti-homosexual bill in Uganda's legislature.
And speaking of Scott Lively,
I have a brother and a sister that went into homosexuality. I know more about this than almost anyone in the world.
Because, after all, he's the only person in the entire world with gay siblings.
The majority of people that I've known that are homosexual were sexually abused as children.
Of course, that is largely due to the fact that Scott is merely interested in validating his religious bigotry. In a fit of confirmation bias, he only seeks out stories about people who were sexually abused.
Lesbianism is really more than anything else. It's an escape from men because sexual abuse by men.
I'm left wondering if Scott actually knows any lesbians other than his sister. I've known hundreds, and very few of them were victims of sexual abuse. One thing I noticed about Scott's videos, he does provide a bit of autobiographical context, and it's clear he had a very unhappy childhood, and apparently he and his siblings were sexually abused. Perhaps that has to do with his obsession and his apparent need to exorcise the past.
Then the second is gender identity confusion. Because if you're a gender identity confused child, and you're a little boy who's manifesting effeminate traits, and there's a homosexual guy, you're an easy target.
Scott enjoys promoting the scurrilous fallacy that homosexuals are almost invariably child molesters.
The third is rebellion against authority. They have a bad attitude. They're not going to go along. They're going to be antisocial. The gay movement is an evil institution. The goal of the gay movement is to defeat the marriage-based society and replace it with a culture of sexual promiscuity.
The Nazis were homosexuals. There would never have been a Nazi party if it hadn't been for the German gay movement.
I am certainly no psychologist, but I will say in closing that indulging in misinformation and propaganda that gets other people killed is a poor way to deal with one's inner demons and self-loathing. Our next nominee shares his concerns about the definition of the term vestigial organs.
My name is J Malakai and you're watching Theory of a Man. In this video, I'd like to talk about vestigial organs.
Well, that is simply orgasmic. What you got to share with us today, sugar britches?
Because vestigial doesn't, and never has, meant functionless. This modern definition of vestigial is not as it always was.
Really? That's surprising. Can we presume that you've spent hours and hours poring over the published scientific research of the last two centuries?
Shorter Oxford English Dictionary 1993 defines vestigial as degenerate or atrophied, having become functionless in the course of evolution.
I see. So you're not depending on the scientific literature, you're depending on a dictionary prepared by non-experts. You know what I smell?
Give me an F! Give me an I!
That's right, fish! In this case, red herring.
It doesn't allow much breathing room for this new version. It's quite clear from the older sources that whatever vestigial organs means to some people now, it used to mean functionless.
Your video reminds me of creationists who claim that the word theory in science simply means an unproven idea. And you're simply wrong about the definition of vestigial organs as represented in the scientific literature. As far back as 1859, when Darwin published The Origin of Species, he dealt with rudimentary, atrophied, and aborted organs, and he stated quite clearly that they can preserve quite well secondary functions. And that's been pretty much the standard view of vestigial organs among biologists since Darwin's day. It's unfortunate that dictionaries preserve kind of a popular vernacular meaning for vestigial. It's also lamentable that you were taught that vestigial means worthless or useless, no longer having a function. But the shortcomings of your education are irrelevant. It's interesting that Darwin in Origin of Species didn't actually use the word vestigial. Vestigial only became a popular word after the 1870s. And given that you seem to be very interested in word usage and dictionaries, I suggest that you might wish to invest in an etymological dictionary that gives you some of the history of words. As it happens, I'm not the first person to address J. Malakai and his remonstrations concerning vestigial organs. That eminent scholar, Desert File, made an excellent video, and this is his shout-out.
I'd like to make a confession.
Then go talk to a priest.
Links in the info bar. Again, this week there's no real contest. J. Malakai is a facile puppy who is stretching his intellectual wings on YouTube. And I'm not going to spank him too hard because I don't think he is a dumb bulb. I just think he needs a little more education. Scott Lively, on the other hand, is a malignant religious bigot. And frankly, someone I think is in sore need of therapy, if not medication. He is an evil person. And his toxic spew is getting people killed.
Were ye born an asshole? Or did you work at it your whole life? Either way it worked out fine, 'cause you're an asshole tonight.
Okay, time for a celebratory beer. We have completed another Coffee with Claire. You guys have a great week. I will see you soon with another video. Bis später.